So unique identifier and key must somehow be meshed together, mixed together somewhere before that and put into the state.
But we did see that there wasn't enough time for both to go in serially, what you would expect. So we knew they had to be merged in some way. And Henrik found an excellent way of finding out.
And then I just ran ahead and just said, okay, if I flip the zeroth bit of the unique identifier, which bit do I have to flip? If I flip the zeroth bit of the unique identifier and flip the zeroth bit of the key, does the authentication still work? The way that I did that is with modified firmware. You can't do that as an attack on an actual reader. I have modified firmware that just ignores the unique identifier that gets sent from the card, but uses its own unique identifier, preset identifier, and it doesn't use the real key, but a modified key. And then I use modified unique identifier and modified key with a real card and a real key in the card. And so I just went on flipping. Flipping bit zero, success. 1, 1, success. 2, 2, success. 3, 3, success. 4, 4, success. 5, 5, no success. I flipped bit 5 in the UID and I tried every other bit in the key and was no success. Then Carsten said, maybe it's I need 2 bits. Okay, I tried all combinations of 2 bits in the key, together with bit 5 in the unique identifier, and I had a success. 5 and 0, bit 5 in the key, and bit 5 and 0 in the unique identifier. Okay, let's increment that. Bit 6 in the key, bit 1 and 6 in the unique identifier, success. 7, 2, 7, success. 8, 3, 8, success. 9, 4, 9, no success. Now comes the cool part. 9, 4, 9, no success. I actually tried again, the 9 and every 2-bit combinations, and didn't find any. So I tried 3-bit combinations. I started with 4, 9, 0, success. And then I noticed a strange scheme appearing because 10, 1, 5, 10. I noticed a strange theme appearing because if you look at these columns, you'll notice that if you represent bit 0, 1, and so on as value, as some value, for example, in hexadecimal, you see 1, 2, 4, 8, 10, 21. And the interesting part is this cell is equal to that cell shifted by 1 every time. You see 2 shifted left by 1 equals 4. 4 shifted left by 1 equals 8. 8 shifted left by 1 is 10. Except for this line where a new bit needs to be flipped at position 0, so I need to OR in a 1. And that extends all the way down. I wrote a program which thus just did this. Try with 0 up there, go down here, notice that 5, 5 won't work, so it tries 5, 5, 0, will then find this one, and goes down, always shifting left, until no success, then set the lowermost bit, least significant bit, and then store the new value and shift it left over and over. And that's what I came up to bit 31, that's the most significant bit of the 32-bit unique identifier. Those bits need to be flipped in order to make everything work with bit 31 flipped in the key. And that's the complete mixing of key and unique identifier. There are no untested combinations in here. I can, for every bit in the key that I want to flip, I can say which bits I need to flip in the unique identifier, and I can calculate that backwards for most of the bits in the unique, for every bit below or equal 31 in the key, I know which bit I need to flip in the unique identifier, and for all bits in the unique identifier, I can calculate which bits I need to flip in the key. So That's completely cool, because if I have two completely different cards, one with the unique identifier X and one with the unique identifier Y, and I can't change the unique identifiers, and key X, then I can calculate key Y so that both cards will start with the same cipher state. I can calculate a key for this card so that it will behave just as if this card, just as if it was this card, despite it having a different unique identifier. I can spoof unique identifiers in the authentication procedure. And that's without any knowledge of the algorithm. That's just, that's not even hardware hacking, that's just playing around in the firmware. And one possible possibility to use that is you need the card emulator, as the guy in the back asked, to spoof the anti-collision procedure and give it out a fake unique identifier. So the reader asks, give me your unique identifier. My emulator says unique identifier X. Okay, the reader tries to authenticate using unique identifier X and key X. And I've specially prepared my card Y with the unique identifier that I can't change and the key that I calculated for this card. And even though both of these are using different unique identifiers and keys, the mutual authentication will succeed and both will talk against, will talk with each other. And the reader is thinking that it talks to card X, but is actually talking to card Y. And that's cool because it's not quite improbable that you have this situation where you have a card with a key that you know. It could be the read key, but you don't know the write key. So you can take a second card where you know the write key, calculate a fitting read key, using this algorithm, and then you have a card that is completely controlled, whose contents are completely controlled by you, and the reader will talk happily with it and thinks it's talking to the original card, which you can't write to. And using this, you can spoof the unique identifier during authentication. For example, if you have, use an access control system and don't have the right unique identifier, and it's not only reading the unique identifier from the anti-collision, but also performing a mutual authentication because it's authentication, then you can spoof that too. The only thing that you can't spoof with this technique is the contents of sector zero. Sector zero is write protected, you can't write to sector zero, and sector zero contains the unique identifier, another copy. So if the access control system would read the unique identifier from sector zero, it, depending on how smart the programmer was, it could notice that something is wrong. You need another technique to against that. For example, which we didn't mention at all until now, it's common knowledge that you don't use stream ciphers and CRC for method authentication. MIFA is using a stream cipher and CRC16 for method authentication. In principle, I can perform a relay attack and flip arbitrary bits in the while they are transferring over the air. That's the same problem that VEP had with the RC4 and CRC. So if I know the contents of the transmission, I can arbitrarily alter it and, for example, spoof the contents of sector zero if I have the equipment for that, which shouldn't be hard. Okay, but that's a cool thing without any special equipment or not a lot of special equipment, and completely breaks the UID and the authentication. And that's all I wanted to show you.
And the lesson to take home from this slide is really to use unique keys for every user, even read keys, because every user can impersonate any other user using this attack.
And those are the cards X and Y. I've modified the key on that card so that the reader, when authenticating to the card, the reader authenticates to both cards just fine with the same unique identifier. I've set up the reader to use a fixed identifier and not use the anti-collision, and it will authenticate to both cards and not notice any difference. Okay.
Thanks
a lot. That's working. More questions? In the back.
Hi. These questions aren't from me. They're from a cryptographer by the name of David Molnar, who wishes he could be here, but unfortunately is stuck in Las Vegas. One is, do you plan to try this on the Oyster card?
Pardon?
Do you plan to try this on the Oyster card?
No, we don't have any Oyster card.
What technology is used in those?
I have one in my pocket.
They're MyFair cards.
Yeah, I know they're MyFair cards.
Well, we broke the Oyster card then.
Yes. So it would be nice if perhaps you, when you release this, you could send him an email. And the second thing is, thoughts on building a secure cipher with similar gate budgets?
Pardon?
What thoughts you might have on building a secure cipher with similar gate budgets?
Well, the Philips themselves, they now build in the same area budget with a lot more gates, the DES, which is a 30-year-old crypto, and that seems the only standardized crypto that does fit on an RFID tag. But we might need to start talking about sacrificing some cryptographic properties to come up with new primitives that would actually fit on RFID tags better, that are custom tailored basically to RFID applications.
So Jake, to answer that question, there was a bunch of cryptographers designing a low gauge cipher based on this, which is called Present 80, if I remember correctly. Those were a couple of people from Bochum and Lars Knudsen, some people from England. It was a rather large team. And this is currently being evaluated for RFIDs. As far as I know, there are no attacks that break the whole cipher yet. So it's 32 rounds. It's a fairly large number of rounds. It's a block cipher. I think the best attack, which is unpublished so far, is 15 or 16 rounds, and that has, so the cipher is aiming for 2 to the 80 security, and I think the best attack right now has 2 to the 75, so that's theoretical still.
Is that the DS-based cipher that uses only one S-box?
No, that is, so this one cipher that uses just one S-box, this is a predecessor of that. This was, okay. I think, a diploma thesis by one of Christoph Parr's students, and Present 80 is basically following that line of research with lots of people who are very knowledgeable in this area and who have looked upon this.
Yeah, and that's exactly the right route to take, to have other people look at it before you sell it as advanced security levels.
Yeah, well, I mean, those guys will know what they're doing, but it still might get broken. So we have to wait like the next 5 or 10 years and see what happens. If we can, if you can't use triple DES or AES, that's, I think, the next best shot that you have.
Okay, thanks for those comments. Any more questions? We have a few minutes left.
Okay.
Well,
that's fine.
Thank you very much for your attention in this last session.